Other than that, let's get to rambling. I got a few things I want to talk about here really quickly. First thing I want to talk about, and this isn't going to be a long rambles, guys. This isn't going to be one of those half-hour rambles. I feel like it took long enough in the Vape Mail portion where I'm going to keep this one relatively short. Hopefully the total video length of this is going to be 15-20 minutes. We will find out where I actually end up at, obviously, when it gets uploaded to YouTube. So, first thing I want to talk about is the Versus video I'm working on right now between the iJoy Maxo and the RX300. Might be somewhere else right now. Anyways, so I'm working on that review right now, or the Versus video. I'm really, really excited with how it's turning out. Honestly, I'm making a list of every single little detail on each one, but it's going to be a list that's well-constructed. So if you remember my last Versus video, I mean, skipping the clone one, the clone versus authentic, because, I mean, I guess that kind of counts, but going back to my last Versus video, it was the Crown versus the TFE4, and it was like a 54-minute long video. I don't know if that's the total time, but it was almost an hour long. It was a lot of rambling, just like I'm doing now. And it was really just not very well constructed because I didn't write anything down. I thought I knew everything in my mind, and I figured there's sub-ohm tanks. How difficult is it going to be to like, it can't be very difficult to explain sub-ohm tanks and the differences. One does more wattage, one does better flavor. What, you know, arguably, of course. Now, when I got down to doing the review, I realized that I almost felt like I almost like blanked, and I just started spouting out a whole bunch of things, and nothing was on track, nothing was delivered the way I wanted it to be delivered. So with this video, I want to have it much more structured. And thinking again, I think another Versus video I did was the Rouleau RX200 versus the Rouleau DNA200. I believe that might have been a more recent one as well. But the point is that I really want to do this in a way where it's structured, it's well put together, and I'm going to be spending a lot of time on editing my videos going forward. I just invested in some new editing software. I'm now using Final Cut Pro, which I'm really excited about. I bought it over the holidays, you know, got a little bit of Christmas money, saved up some pennies here and there, and put it towards some software. And I'm looking forward to doing more editing and longer editing. So, you know, typically a video would take anywhere, you know, an actual one that gets released, because some of the videos that I record never get released. And, you know, either I re-record it, or if I feel like there's already too many out by the time I get around to doing it again, or to recording it again, I almost feel like I just let it go. I've had a couple of them where, for example, I think there was one, the Rock Vape, it was called the Rock Vape RDTA, but it was actually an RTA, although sort of. A lot of people gave it negative reviews. Honestly, I actually didn't mind it. You know, so I think it was, I don't want to like call anyone out on this, but you know, I totally understand where they were coming from, but I believe it was Ambition Vapor or someone like that who did the review on it, and I watched it, and you know, seeing his review versus my review on it, it was two completely different perspectives, and I can see why. You know, he's more of a builder than I am. He does a lot more building. For me personally, I put a build in there and I expect it to last months. And that's with even my RDAs. Like, for example, in this RDA in Lagoon right now, I just finally switched out the saddle horse coils, which I was actually torn to do. I didn't want to do it, but I ruined them myself. I was cleaning them, and I tried to re-wick it, and I messed up the coil completely. It was unsalvageable. But the good news is, the bright side of that is, despite the fact of ruining a beautiful coil by saddle horse, I got to put another beautiful coil in there, and I got to put in the coil that DMD Vape sent me, which I am absolutely in love with. And this thing is just, I mean, 150 watts, it's hitting no problem at all. It's beautiful flavor, absolutely stunning amount of vapor for what you're getting, although that's 150 watts, I mean, that's kind of to be expected. The only downside, of course, is that it's a little bit low resistance, but so is the saddle horse coil. They're both around a 0.09. And the reason why I say that is because in this upcoming Versus video, one of the two devices only fires down to 0.1, at least for now. I'm working on seeing if there's an update that will adjust that, and I've also contacted Wismec themselves. We'll see if they get back to me or not, because I actually contacted them on another matter a couple months ago for something else I was going to do a review on for them, and they never got back to me, so hopefully they get back to me this time. Wismec, I'm calling you out right now. You better respond to my emails. Anyways, so the point is, and I guess just ruined which one goes down to 0.1, but the RX300 only goes down to 0.1. This one goes down to 0.06. And for a quad battery, that seems pretty reasonable, especially if you're using it in a pulse setting environment or in a pulse setting. And what I mean by that is you're not taking long hauls, i.e. 6-7 seconds. You know, even 6-7 seconds. Who am I kidding? Pulse is essentially you're not doing a continuous run of the batteries at that output, I guess. And I know I'm having a really hard time explaining this. I wasn't planning on doing a battery education video in the middle of a rant, but hopefully you understand what I'm trying to say. What I'm trying to say is impulse, you're going to be able to run this at, you know, 0.08 reasonably, providing the batteries you use are well made and they're not cheap knockoff batteries. Assuming that, it should be no issue. So setting the resistance down to 0.1, I see where they're coming from. And in the versus video, I don't think I'm going to knock them for that. I'm not going to take points off for that particular issue because I can see it being a pro as well as a con. My big concern, though, and what I will take points off for, is if they do not respond to my email. I get it. I'm just another guy asking another dumb question. But in all honesty, everyone deserves to have answers to their questions, regardless of how good or bad they are. So, in my personal opinion, I feel like customer service is going to come into play in a lot more reviews going forward. And what kind of sparked that wasn't even the RX300. In fact, honestly, I would have just let it go in the review and just mentioned that as it fires down to 0.1 and then let you guys be the judge if that's a good or a bad thing. But what sparked the whole interest in customer service is getting another H cigar product to review. As I mentioned in the previous unboxing video I just posted yesterday or 2 days ago, depending on when this video gets posted, you will probably know that I had previously put a boycott out on H cigar. And the reason being wasn't because my device bricked. Although in my unboxing video yesterday, if that's all you've seen as far as that H cigar rant and never actually saw the whole thing that I originally posted, then it may look like I was just bashing it because it bricked. Every device has a chance of bricking. By the way, speaking of bricking, my RX2/3 bricked about a month ago. I forgot to put that out on video. I don't know if I ever mentioned it or not, but that was very disappointing. And honestly, I'm going to say this right now, stay away from RX2/3. They are not good. And it, within 1 week of mine bricking, my brother's bricked. Someone else at the stores brought theirs in because it bricked. And then someone else is bricked, but only with 3 batteries. And what I mean by that is it didn't work with 3 batteries, but it would work with 2. Now, just to make sure they weren't using unmarried batteries in case that ever became an issue, or maybe they were charging it in the device itself and maybe it became unbalanced. I don't know what would have caused that, but I confirmed by putting my married set of 18650s in there, the triple set I have, and it would not run them. It was completely dead. But yet putting 2 batteries in there, it worked no problem. So my guess is there was some sort of issue with the connection on that one because it has to be the backing with the 3 batteries or even with 2 batteries has to make a proper connection, as I bump the microphone, has to make a proper connection for it to actually even power on. And I'm guessing there was something causing an issue with the connection. So I wouldn't say it necessarily bricked, but it did become less of a product than what the person paid for. Anyway, so getting back to H cigar, the point I'm really trying to make here isn't about, you know, the fact that it bricked. My point I was trying to make, and if you watched the Do Not Buy From H cigar video I posted, I think that's actually what it's called too. I think it's called Do Not Buy From H cigar. Robbie Rambles or something like that. But the point is, in that video, I explained the whole process and why I was so pissed off. The Cliff Notes version of it is that after numerous emails, after sending them my device for them to fix, I never heard back from them. I never got any responses to my emails. No one replied to me. No one gave me an update on where things were at. And it just became this huge process that just frustrated me to the point where I literally emailed them and gave them like 2 weeks notice, something like that, and said, look, if you don't respond to this email, I'm a reviewer, here's how many subscribers I have. And I mean, it doesn't matter how many subscribers you have, and it shouldn't, but I was using it as trying to get leverage, as hoping that the video would go viral so that it would, you know, it would really bite them in the ass. And so I said that, and I said, look, I'm a reviewer, I do videos. If you do not respond to my email, I will have no choice but to put a message out to YouTube explaining my frustrations to everyone. And still nothing. So after, you know, this is going probably 3 months in the process since I sent them my device and since the device originally bricked out. And, you know, at this point, it got me frustrated, right? Because, and the reason why it got me frustrated isn't just because it bricked out and I didn't have it anymore. Because I had other mods I could use, but the problem is not everyone did. A lot of people bought that mod and didn't have backup mods, and not everybody has a backup mod. And if they do, chances are it's usually of lesser quality or of a lower wattage than what they're used to or something. And it's something just there to, as an emergency backup. So going 3 months without a mod is absolutely unacceptable. Now, I will say this, it was bought from the Vape Depot. The Vape Depot actually refunded me and all the other people whose VT200s bricked, and there was, I think there was four or five of them out of the six that were brought in. So it was a substantial number. And what bothered me the most was the customer service. The fact that they didn't have enough decency to get back to me, and they didn't have enough decency to get back to anyone else who actually bothered to write in. Now, most people who got their money back from the Vape Depot didn't think to write in. I wrote in because I thought it was unfair, because the Vape Depot wasn't getting compensated now for compensating me for the VT200 breaking out. Now, the Vape Depot obviously has great customer service. Jay's an amazing guy. And that being said, I'm going to stand up for him. And it wasn't, you know, me coming at them from Jay's angle. It was me coming at them from a consumer angle. And, you know, the best way to compare, and here's why I have to put this comparison in, by the way. In the comment section of that H Cigar video, Do Not Buy From H Cigar, a lot of people were saying, well, it's the chip's fault. It's the chip that bricked out. Why aren't you emailing the Evolve? If you email Evolve, it'll be resolved and blah, blah, blah. And here's where my thought process is, okay? Recently in the media, in the news, or the media, whatever you want to call it, recently there was a case. I'm not going to name any brand names because I don't know if I can get in trouble for that, but just in case. Recently in the news, there was a case of a car manufacturer having a massive recall because a part made by a third party was deemed to be dangerous. Apparently, exploding metal in the face is dangerous. Hint, hint. The point I'm trying to make is, rather than said car company saying, oh, if you want to get a new car, or if you want to trade in your car, or if you want to get the part replaced or repaired, you got to talk to this third party manufacturer that you really have had no contact with ever before in your life, and you have to go to them to fix our car. It's the same thing with the VT200 and why it bothered me so much. Because if you're putting a device out, I don't care whose chip you're using, I don't care whose parts you're using, you are responsible for the entire device. Please understand that. Now, I know it sounds harsh, I know what I'm coming across as angry, and honestly, getting that H cigar yesterday in the vape mail from GearBest reignited that anger. And I'm still upset with the whole thing to this day, and even more so now that I've seen another H cigar product on my desk. I don't blame GearBest. Obviously, I don't. And I'm sure if anyone had issues with a product that was from GearBest, they should have no issue getting an exchange or a refund or a return. I will probably test that out at one point. I'm not going to say when, I'm not going to say how. I'm just going to try and test it out at one point to verify that. And that's just for your sake as well as my own. But going back to H Cigar, what bothered me the most about this is the fact that they did not take responsibility, they didn't have the decency to respond, and yet it was their product. I don't care if it was a third party's chip. I don't care if it was a third party's battery even. It's your product, support it. You don't see car manufacturers telling you they won't support it because it was made by a third party. When you buy a car, you buy a car. You're not buying the name and individual parts made by third parties. Just like when you buy a mod or something like that, you're not buying the mod, you're not buying the chip separately, you're not buying the battery separately and putting it together yourself. You're buying a package. And with that package comes a certain level of standards that should be upheld to really reinforce your product and your brand. Your brand is on the line. I don't care if Evolve's chip was the problem of that whole thing. Even if it was, it's your product. You're just using a third-party company to supply parts for your product. Please understand that. I'm going to leave it there, but again, just know where I'm coming from and know why I'm so angry with them, and please do not tell me, well, you should have went to Evolve, because Evolve did not sell me and did not make that particular mod. Evolve made the chip and made a component in that mod. H Cigar made the VT200 and therefore needs to be responsible for any of these devices that bricked out. End of rant. So basically, after all that rambling, what I really wanted to get to the point of was just saying that I'm in the works of creating a list and creating kind of a draft for that actual versus video, and I'm comparing everything. I'm trying to get everything involved so it's a perfectly fair decision. and we'll see how it turns out. I actually think, based on, it's funny because actually as I was writing things down and as I was going through things and using them both yesterday and today, I've actually noticed a few things with them. And I feel like I've got enough information down where I can make a pretty good versus video, as in like right now. But I had also said I was going to wait 2 or 3 weeks. The only thing I really have left to test outside of durability, which of course could be an issue, but it could be an issue 3 months down the road as well. And obviously, as a reviewer, I can't wait 3 months to put out a review on this, especially on a versus video where in 3 weeks, these devices could be obsolete by then. And especially with the way the market's going right now. Anyways, the point I'm trying to make here is I think I can get this video done and get all the information I'm looking for in the versus video within the next week. The only thing I have left to really go over is the battery life. And in order to do the battery life tests, I'm going to do it at different wattages. What kind of battery life am I getting on each of these at 75 watts? What kind of battery life am I getting at about 125 watts? And what kind of battery life am I getting at either 150 or 175? I haven't decided yet. Am I going to run these at max? Sure. I'll build a coil that can handle 300 watts and I will do a video, or I'll put a quick section in it at them both hitting at the maximum output, the 315 for the Maxo and the 300 for the RX300, just so you guys can see that as well. But that's not going to be a determination in the review by any stretch, and my criteria for evaluating who's going to win that versus match is going to be much more broader than just what one hits harder, which makes sense, because honestly, I don't think a lot of people are going to be buying these for the 300 watts. Yes, there's some people out there who will be running it at 300 watts as a novelty one or two times, and there's other people out there who are going to be running it at 300 watts on a regular basis just because they can. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. Who am I to judge? I've obviously fucked up enough with some of my other videos I've done, so I have no room to judge in where I stand on that. What I do think, though, is important, and why I do think some people might be able or might be interested in buying these two devices or one of these two devices, comes down to battery life. Having four batteries, I assume you get better battery life, and that's going to be the test in as far as battery life is concerned. So with that in mind, that's what I have working on for the versus video. I'm super excited. That's why I wanted to talk about it a lot more. Outside of that, a few other things, I guess, just to go over some other things that I'm working on. I'm actually going to be doing a device review with the Depot crew tomorrow, or I guess tonight, depending on when this is released, on Friday. It's currently Thursday, so I'm going to try and get this published tonight, but if not, I will try and publish it. I'll definitely have it published tomorrow. It's just going to depend on the format I use to upload it. If I use H.264, and some of you may have seen my previous Vape Mail video, if I use the format H.264, then I know it'll upload tonight and it'll be at a reasonable time, so I'll let it go live. But if I keep the format in a larger file size, I find my audio quality is so much better. Of course, if I remember to actually cut out the background noise, because I do have a fish tank in the background, which I could kind of hear if I had the volume all the way up on my MacBook Mini or my MacBook Air. Because my speakers on the MacBook Air I find aren't great, and so I tend to turn up the volume all the way when I'm watching a video. And I don't know, maybe I'm deaf. I don't know. Maybe I have hearing problems. But the point is, I do that, and only when the volume's up all the way do I tend to notice that background noise. So I'll just eliminate it anyways in this one. I'm getting off topic here. The point I'm trying to make is, depending on what file size I decide to go with for this video, will probably depend on, you know, do I really need to get it up today? I just posted a video yesterday. I know I was running behind. This doesn't even get me caught up, really. I still have to work on that last part of the vape bag video I'm doing for GearBest, and then a couple other reviews I'm doing, and then a couple non-reviews I'm doing with the Depot crew. And I don't want to waste too much time, but at the same time, I also, you know, I'm okay waiting a day to get this video out if it has to, especially if it means the audio is going to be night and day. I didn't get a lot of feedback on the last video I did on the unboxing or on the vape mail video as far as the audio. I had a couple people say audio sounds fine to me, but my biggest comparison I want to do is, how do you think the audio sounds in a video like the Vape Mail GearBest edition that I just posted on Wednesday, or another video? The only other video that I uploaded in the larger file size was a Billion Lives giveaway I'm doing for Calgary. That was actually uploaded in the larger file size to test the audio. That was the first test I did with the audio. And any other video I've done, especially a review, you know, with this new microphone kind of thing, check out one of those ones and then check out the one I did yesterday. I'm not going to commit to checking out this one because, again, I haven't decided what file format it's going to be in. But check out that one and check out the one I did yesterday on the Gear Best Vape Mail Edition. Part one, maybe. Maybe I'll call this one part two / Rambles. But check out that one. Let me know your thoughts on it. Let me know if you notice a drastic difference. And do you think it's worth the extra time it takes to upload that file size? And it's a lot of extra time. An H.264 for a 7-minute video, which is what it was yesterday, would have taken roughly between uploading and processing time for YouTube. I would say it would take about 40 minutes to an hour at the most. Yesterday, it actually took 3 hours. So 3 hours to upload is a long time to wait. Does the three times the upload time difference make that much of a difference in audio to you guys? Let me know what you think in the comments below, and I will, you know, judge accordingly on how I upload future videos as per your comments. Other than that, I think that's pretty much all I wanted to ramble about. Hopefully you guys are liking these new video styles I'm doing. Hopefully you guys are enjoying, you know, the Depot crew a lot more. I'm involving them a ton in my videos. We're basically doing recording once a week, which is awesome. And tomorrow I think we're going to do two recordings. We're going to do one for the actual mod review together, which is going to be a really cool experience. We're all going to have a chance to review the same mod. I only got one of them, so there's going to be some germs passed around. But if you're not too cringed up by that, definitely take a look at that one. And we're also going to do a juice review tomorrow as well, and possibly even a third video, but I don't want to make promises on that one yet because it's still in the works. So let me know what you think on that. Is this new format style for 2017, the new Robbie Vapes 2017, working for you guys? You know, are you guys enjoying the videos more? And I hope you are, but I think my way to judge personally is that I'm enjoying my videos more. I watch my videos now, and I watch them all. The last probably 5 or 6 videos I've posted, maybe even more than that now, I've really enjoyed watching my own videos. And in the past, it almost felt like a chore to watch my own videos. And I was like, you know what, I'm so bored right now, I just want to, like, forget it. I'll just, you know, upload it and it'll be fine. But that's not the way to do this. If I'm going to really take this seriously and really try to, you know, make something in my channel this year and improve it for all of you guys, in order to do that, what I really have to be doing is stepping up my game. And I cannot get lazy. I cannot get, you know, to the point where I'm just throwing videos out left and right. And I'm going to be a lot more picky on my videos as well. So let me know what you guys think. If the Depot crew is something that you want to see more of, we will absolutely involve them more. If you don't like the videos, honestly, I still think I'm going to keep doing them. So if you don't like the Depot crew videos, you don't have to watch them. They're usually longer videos because all of us just sitting there chatting. We're socializing. And what I'm trying to highlight in those videos is that is the aspect of the social aspect of vaping that a lot of us reviewers don't really capture in our reviews. Because a lot of us see their device and we're just focused on the device and does it work, does it not work. But if you're a new vapor coming into this scene and you're looking at these reviews, they kind of seem kind of lonely. Because all the reviews are just one person talking about a device. Maybe, you know, Matt and V, they share the reviews sometimes. Sure, that's an option. And there's other people who do that as well. But the point I'm trying to make is we don't really capture what goes on outside of these reviews very well. And that's why I wanted to involve the Depot crew a lot more. Because honestly, if I get something sent to me, especially juice, even when I was just doing the review myself, all I was really doing was doing the review myself. And then literally the next day going to the Depot and sharing the juice with everybody else there to see what their thoughts are. Now the only difference is I'm actually recording it with them as opposed to recording my version and then keeping the social aspect private, which doesn't make any sense because if a new reviewer stumbles on these reviews and they start seeing the social aspect, that might get them more engaged in vaping from the perspective of I'm no longer, like it was with cigarettes, you know, on my own. There is a social aspect to this. There is a community involved in this. And it's something that we really have to focus on a lot more. I'm not saying as reviewers, I'm just saying in general. We should really be promoting the community aspect of this. And I feel like, you know, outside of promoting things like, oh, you know, My Vaporium or VapeFam.net or VapeFam.org. If Phenom watches this, correct me what it is in the comments below. I'll probably have a link to it in the description as well. But the point is, we promote these social communities and then the social aspect of vaping, but we don't show it. We don't show ourselves as part of that community. And I know, I think it was Mark and Mike have uploaded some videos, and I think Billy's uploaded some videos. of him meeting up with other reviewers at vape meets and things like that. And I know other reviewers have done the same thing. And that's exactly what we need to see. We need to see more focus on the social aspect and what happens behind the camera. Just let's pretend we're behind the camera, but actually have the camera in front of us the whole time. Hopefully that makes sense to you guys. Other than that, I think it's interesting because with all the talk about social aspect, I'm actually working on a video right now. It's just in theory. I haven't started filming it or anything yet, but I'm working on a video right now that focuses on what I believe to be the backbone of the vape industry. And I say that now and why it's a perfect segue from the community aspect and the social aspect, because it's not the social aspect. The social aspect is amazing. The social aspect would be kind of like the, how can I put it? I mean, it would be the support of the body. If what I want to talk about in this upcoming video is the backbone, this would be the support for the backbone. This is what helps the backbone and also helps everyone else in the community as well. But I want to focus on the backbone of the vaping community and what it actually entails, in my personal opinion. You may disagree. You may think it's social aspect. You may think it's the choice of, or the choices we have today. You may think it is the way we represent ourselves. Because I know a lot of vapers, seriously guys, you should be proud. The way we represent ourselves in public, yes, there's a couple bad apples. But for the most part, you guys should honestly be very proud of yourselves for how you represent yourself and how you, the kind of image you maintain throughout the general public. And I've seen it more and more often again, especially recently, the way people are very respectful these days, the way people are less inclined to do something stupid. It all adds up to give us a better image. And while I do absolutely think that that's a huge representation of the vaping community, I don't necessarily think of it as the backbone of the community. And even as I'm thinking this right now through my analogy, I'm actually going to change up a little bit. The community is the backbone. The community aspect, the social aspect, is the backbone of the vaping industry. What I'm looking to do a topic on, though, is not the backbone. It's going to be the heart of vaping. What is the heart of vaping? What pumps out, you know, the blood in the body? What fuels the backbone? And what fuels the rest of the body in the vaping community? And I want to focus on this aspect more so than ever. And I know it sounds like I don't know what I'm talking about, or I don't know how to relate what I'm talking about to an analogy, and that's because I failed English, almost, 59%, still a pass. Anyways, so what I'm trying to say is, I know what I want to put this focus on for this video, have the main topic set as, I know what I want to do it on, but in order to promote it right, I need to make sure that you guys understand in relation to how important I feel it is to the community. This one aspect is, in my opinion, the most important thing to the community, including the social aspect, which is a very, very close second. So other than that, that's what I want to talk about. A whole bunch of videos in the works. I really hope you guys enjoy this one. I hope you guys enjoyed the ramble. Obviously I got a lot to say, and I'm sure I could ramble on for hours and hours, you know, longer, but I think I'll cut it off here. I believe we're already past that 20-minute limit mark that I set, you know, 20 minutes ago, but hopefully you guys enjoy it. And again, thank you guys so much for watching. Thank you guys for all the support. I really do appreciate it. And again, let me know down below in the comments what you think of the audio in my last video. This one's honestly probably gonna be uploaded in H.264 to save space and to save time on uploading because it's already been so long. So even if you want to compare it, you can compare the audio in this video, the H.264 video, to the one I posted just before this video, which is the GearBest, we'll call it part one, Vape Mill Edition. And the Vape Mill Edition part one is going to have the higher resolution and higher image format, whereas this one is going to be the more compressed one. And we're going to see if you guys notice a difference in the audio quality. And let me know down below what your thoughts are. Is it worth it to wait the extra couple hours to upload a video with better audio quality, or is the difference negligible and honestly you don't really care and it's you're okay with it being uploaded in this compressed format? So thank you guys all so much again for watching, and I hope you guys liked the video. Hope you guys, you know, are having a great day. It's almost Friday, or it might be Friday depending on when I post this, so happy Friday either way. And again, thank you guys all so much. I'll see you guys next time. Happy vaping, YouTube.